God, I look like a glow in the dark world.
The brightness is too much. You wore black so that you look thin.
Yeah. Don't put this on the finger.
But what did you say?
Nothing about our hair.
Not this time. Why are you so stiff? Relax. Wait. You want to hide your stomach in the Hi guys, what's up? It's Sarah and welcome back to my channel. For today's video, we are doing another episode of Skin Talk with Sarah and I have a very special guest here with me. This is Dr. Anish Sheth. He's the founder of the skincare company called Dr. Sheth's, which is an Indian skincare company. It's specifically designed for skin of color and I'm at his clinic right now. So we have him here today to answer a bunch of our skincare queries. I took a poll on like YouTube as well as on my Instagram stories and there were so many questions that flooded in. So we are going to take the hottest questions and quiz you today. But before that, let him introduce himself and tell us more about yourself, your brand and everything.
Sure. So my brand was actually started, our experience with skincare was started by my grandfather. And he first was one of the first dermatologists in India. He started the dermatology department at KEM Hospital. His daughter, Dr. Rekha Sheth, was a very well-known dermatologist and she was India's first cosmetic dermatologist. And she had an extreme passion in Indian skin because she felt that a lot of the solutions and a lot of the research that was happening on Caucasian skin or Japanese skin. And skin of color tends to be a little different. By skin of color, I'm referring to brown skin. And that tends to be a little different because we have melanin, we have a lower content of ceramides, we tend to have a faster transepidermal water loss, which means that water evaporates from our skin really fast. And as a result of which, we have what we call extremely sensitive skin, so we tend to pigment a lot easier. So that's how the genesis of the entire idea started. Now, I'm a pharmacist, I'm a pharmacologist, I did my PhD in pharmacology. I studied everything from how you discover a drug, how you test that drug, how you formulate that drug in order to administer it to people. And it just felt great working with my mom to kind of create solutions that work exclusively for Indian skin. I think we were kind of tired of using and relying on Western products when India needs its own products. We have a different environment, we have a different world.
True.
You know? And that's why we started the brand.
It's amazing. I love every single product I've tried from you till now. I found out about your company very recently. So ever since I've like been a fan and I've reached out to him personally, we should do this video because like, what do you think about all the dermatologists and cosmetologists who are now taking over social media and like creating their own channel? Where are we seeing your channel?
Hopefully one day soon, once my brand gets a little more stable, I do want to start a channel where I talk about ingredients. And I think it's great that we have so many experts starting their social media because people who don't know their shit will get called out. People need to, battle misinformation.
Very important, especially like with skin, people are so obsessed with their skin, but then they'll take any information that comes their way. Like you won't really check the source that it's coming from and you'll just grasp every single information that you're getting from no reliable source. So it's great that we have so many, like, do you realize that social media now has a bigger influence with your company? Like, does it help your company work better? Because like there are a lot of companies that I still know who don't really rely much on social media marketing.
No, I think if you don't rely on social media, not just in terms of marketing, but even in terms of product development, even in terms of feedback.
Correct,
Like you're really not a company in this day and age if you don't rely on social media. Like I personally like to be in touch with my community because I've had people message me the best, nicest compliments as well as the worst insults. There's always something to gain when you're directly in touch with your customer.
True. So fragrance was a big issue that there were a lot of questions about that as well. So what is your take on fragrance? And I know that you all have actively made a change in your skincare products when it comes to fragrance. So why did you all do that? And did you like consider something before doing that? Because I know that you said fragrances because consumers take the products better when there's a fragrance in it. So why the change, and now do you see the consumerism increase now that the fragrance is not there?
So we know that customers, so when my mom did her study, it was a different time. There were different people then. There were different, you know, there wasn't so much access to information as there is now.
True.
I definitely think fragrance can be sensitizing, but it's not always about the poison. It's about the dose that makes it a poison. Like, you can drown from water and you can quench your thirst. So, you know, you want to make sure that, I personally, you guys know, I'm not opposed to fragrance, but I have to create what my community wants me to create. And if my community wants me to create fragrance-free products, I'm going to do that. So I think that, you know, we'll see that the next round of products that are coming out, you know, since the ABC cleanser, the Neem BHA, yeah. They don't have fragrance. We're going to stop using fragrance to see how it impacts. You know, at the end of the day, a company is based on its sales. So if it does sell well, then we definitely will stick to it. Or maybe we'll do both. Have some products with fragrance and some products without fragrance.
That's great. Then I think there's something for everyone. In
right. I mean, a poll that we did on our internet, which is just, you know, like our social media community, showed that 86% of people don't want fragrance and only 14% do want fragrance.
Yeah, now so. The awareness has increased. So now people have started to realize, like, back in the day, I just used peers on my face and I was cool with it. Like, I never really cared much about my skin until I came on YouTube and people started questioning my skin is when I was like, maybe I should do something about it.
That's it. Fragrance is not a bad thing. You know, it's just, it's in some cases, there are some products. So for example, lactic acid, mandelic acid, like lactic acid smells like feet. Like, you don't want to apply that on your face. You know, so you want something that will kind of make that
Pleasant experience.
Or yeah, like, you know, cancel that experience.
Correct.
Like, so that's something that we have to think about, and it's definitely a challenge, you know, in order to do that. But other products, it's totally fine. Like, they just smell like products, like ghee, you know, and but not like the nice kind of mithai kind of ghee.
Yeah. Okay, so since we're on the topic of acids, let's tap into chemical exfoliation, because there were a lot of questions about what is the right age to start and how you're supposed to layer your skincare when it comes to chemical exfoliation, and is it the only cure now for like everything that we are looking at the internet? Because people feel like acne, chemical exfoliation, melasma, chemical exfoliation, skin tags, chemical exfoliation. So the hype has increased tenfold in lockdown. Don't you realize that?
I definitely think so, because I think people have access to time, and so they were more open to experimenting.
Correct, yeah.
And I think there's more access to information. That said, I don't use the word cure very
openly
or very easily, because these are recurrent diseases that occur as a result of either your lifestyle or a result of your environment. So I wouldn't say that chemical exfoliation, like, don't expect chemical exfoliation to be, you know, the miracle cure for everything. You know, chemical exfoliation, at the end of the day, you are just removing the dead skin cells off your face in a very calm manner if you're using the right products. Now, a product at the end of the day is a product. It's going to work whether or not, like, if you put salt in water, whether or not you want it to, it's going to dissolve. Similarly, you put an acid on your face, whether you want it to or not, it's going to dissolve the top layer of your face. As a result of this, if you over exfoliate, your skin will be irritated, your skin will be itchy, your skin will be red. And Indian skin anyway has a weak barrier. That doesn't mean that you shouldn't exfoliate, it just means that you should do it in moderation. You know, it's like every now and then you want that piece of sugar, but you don't want to have, like, you don't want to be a diabetic. You know, you don't want to become a diabetic. So you need to monitor that carefully. Don't use, like, in terms of age, I think you can use it as early as 12 plus if you have acneic skin. If you don't have acneic skin, 20 plus is a good age to use it at. So a lot of, like, for people, you know, when they come to the dermat's office, you know, when we have our team of dermats, and if the acne is really bad, the scars are really bad, the pigmentation is really bad, they will prescribe them a higher strength peel because it's appropriate for that specific patient. You know, there's nothing wrong if you use it like 13 plus, 12 plus. But if you're using it just for maintenance, 20 plus is a good age to start. You know, and I think that be really, really careful with concentrated peels. Make sure you're using reputable brands. There's a lot of brands on the market now, and one thing we have to understand is that the regulatory system in India is not like it is in the West. you know, there's a lot of people, a lot of brands, and we only have so many resources to be able to police these brands. So think about that. Unless it's a brand that you recognize with trust, or you're able to access the people from the brand to be able to question them on things, you don't want to play with fire.
Yeah.
You know, like I said, if you apply something that doesn't work for you, you're going to deal with pigmentation that may take up to 6 months, you know, to kind of recover from.
That's right. So basically be like very wary about what you're putting on. Question everything, especially when it comes to like all these acids, because they are like super potent, and if they're not formulated well, that is the main catch, right? You told me. So it's not just about the ingredient list, it's also about the formulation and how stable the forms are that they are putting in the product. Let's dive into the next question now, diving like a little farther away from acne. Let's discuss about face icing. So that's another popular question, that does face icing really help, and what is the whole scientific reasoning behind face icing?
So it's kind of like when you get injured, say you sprain your wrist or you sprain your knee or ankle, you're gonna, first thing you're going to do is put ice on it, right?
True.
So in that sense, the ice will reduce the inflammation on your face. So for example, if somebody comes here for a laser treatment, they will follow the laser treatment with an ice pack, you know, or like an ice towel, because that's going to reduce the inflammation. But other than that, it's not going to, I don't know the claims that are being associated with
there
ice.
There is pore minimizing, there is, people think it gets rid of pores.
So nothing's going to get rid of your pores.
thank you for saying that.
I think like, if you get rid of your pores, then you're probably an android. But there's nothing that, it's not going to, it can, you know, like, so your pores are basically your hair follicles. So people call pores are hair follicles. And what happens is that sometimes when it's warm, you know, they kind of get a little bigger and you get sweat. And sometimes when it's a little cooler, they tend to like contract a little bit.
Correct.
But whether or not that's a visible difference depends on how strong your microscope is. And like a lot of people confuse ice pick scars. So there are scars when people, when you squeeze out your acne and you're not supposed to, you get an ice pick scar because it's like an ice pick. You know, and that people say is like they have pores, they think that it's a pore. But that's not a pore, and icing will not help that at all. Like for that, you're going to have to go through a little deeper therapy to have like, you know, certain deep like peels, subcision, things like that.
Because that scar is pretty deep in your skin, it's not superficial.
Right.
So now another trend that has been going on all over the internet is vitamin C. It has like really picked up in this whole lockdown situation, and everyone wants to start layering vitamin C. So what's like the best way to go about with using vitamin C on your skin, especially for Indian skin? Because I personally feel every time I use a concentrated amount, I break out. So I don't know. And once I said it in one of my videos, and somebody like came at me that it's not the vitamin C, it's something else that's breaking you out. So
a lot depends. So now vitamin C is a little complicated, because you have vitamin C, which is ascorbic acid.
Correct.
Now, I particularly don't like that molecule. It's the most well studied, but I particularly don't like it because it results in a lot of irritation, particularly in our skins where the barrier tends to be compromised. So unless it's formulated in a particular way, like what we call encapsulated, it's not something I would recommend. If for a stronger dose of vitamin C, I would use a derivative like 3-O-ethyl ascorbic acid or tetrahexyl ascorbate. THD ascorbate is what we call it. And those tend to be less irritating on the skin. Of course, more studies will be done. Again, vitamin C, glutathione, they are antioxidants. You know, they're good for your skin.
Yeah, glutathione.
We'll come to that in a minute. Yeah. So they're good for your skin, but they're not going to like make you like remove all your pigmentation overnight or things like that.
Correct.
It's, you probably start seeing the effects of vitamin C, like, you know, if you're using it now regularly in about 5 years, you'll see like, you won't age. I mean, you'll see results before that, but the real results is that it reduces the rate at which you age.
Okay.
So it helps produce collagen, make like maintain the collagen that you have. So it's essentially, it's a great molecule. There's no doubting that. But you know, I think skincare is all about managing your expectations.
How to cure acne? So like acne is like the biggest thing. There's something about fungal acne, there is something about cystic acne, there is something about back acne. So what do you think the general approach should be to
So first of all, there's no such thing as fungal acne. Like that's not a thing. It's just something that the internet made up, and now it's like getting trendy because more and more people are searching for it and they want a new disease to call themselves. So it's not a thing. it's a fungal disease, if it is what you're thinking about, that let a dermatologist decide if it is the fungal disease or it's acne. Now, talking about acne depends actually on the cause of the acne. And predominantly, the acne is caused either by your hormones, by genetics, or by your lifestyle. So one of these three buckets will eventually, and they're not mutually exclusive, there's often an overlap between each of these. And in order to cure, quote unquote, cure your acne, you have to address these issues at an equal level. So for example, it's hormonal, you'd be prescribed things like spironolactone, which is a drug that's often used for birth control. Oftentimes you'll be prescribed a retinoid, an oral retinoid, which works really well. Of course, pregnant women and women breastfeeding, conceiving, can't take it. But you know, it's a combination of these sorts of treatments at an oral level. Topically, you use things like salicylic acid, benzoyl peroxide, topical retinoids. Combination of these work. Body acne, again, Indian people particularly, because we have so much hair, particularly men will have a lot of back acne. Women who have PCOD will tend to have body acne all over their body because their hormones are fighting on the inside. So for that, a topical approach is to use a 2% salicylic acid wash, use a spot treatment on the acne, things like that. Benzoyl peroxide wash is also really helpful. Depends on the cause of the acne before you're able to quote unquote cure it. I know it's trendy to like try this acid and that acid and this acid. I think one of the only acids you should be trying on a regular basis is hyaluronic acid.
Okay, and there was a question about how do you layer hyaluronic acid and how do you get like the most out of it?
So usually what you can do is a sandwich method is what I like. So you put a moisturizer, you put hyaluronic acid and put another moisturizer on top. That really helps.
That's like too much, no? But
it depends on what your skin type is. I'm assuming that this is someone who's really dry skin.
Okay.
If you don't have dry skin, then I would just put hyaluronic acid and then put a moisturizer on top. So the hyaluronic acid will attract the moisture from the outside.
Correct.
And the moisture and the emollient in the moisturizer will seal it in.
Okay.
So it's always helpful. Nowadays,
have to put a moisturizer on top of hyaluronic acid serum.
No, so that's what I'm saying. So nowadays the serums are formulated as such that they already have some level of emolliency.
Okay.
So you don't need it, but if you want to do it and you want to like, you know, really make your skin supple and soft, you know, that's a good way to go about it.
Okay. Okay, great.
That said, if you layer your skin wrong, nothing's gonna happen. Like you're still gonna get absorbed, you know, anything's
just it's one of the safe acids, like you're not messing up your skin barrier with that. Alright.
Okay, so the next question is somebody asking about glutathione. So I've heard a lot about it causing cancer and like rumors about that, or it helping treat cancer, and it's very like people promote it as a skin lightening, whitening ingredient. So what's your take on that? Because I don't promote skin whitening, lightening.
I don't think anybody should promote skin whitening, lightening. I mean, we're living in the 21st century. Do you really want to promote skin? Like, look what's happening to... I don't want to say the brand's name to give them publicity, but we all know what we're talking about.
Yeah.
So I think glutathione, it's never about... Like, don't hate on the poison. Hate on the dose. So... In smaller doses, it's great as an antioxidant, it's great orally, it's great, you know, if it's in a well-formulated product.
Correct.
In regards to it curing cancer, it's not going to cure cancer. What it does is that it reduces the efficacy of some cancer treatments, not all, because what happens, a lot of cancer...
Reduces the efficacy,
right.
Okay.
So a lot of cancer treatments work by destroying cancer cells by over-oxidating them.
Correct.
So when you put any antioxidant, like I would equate it at the same stage as like a vitamin C.
Okay.
So even if you give a cancer patient a vitamin C, those cancer treatments will work less effectively.
Okay.
So that's something to keep in mind. What does happen, and I think what people are using it for and what you're referring to, is injectable IV glutathione. Now what happens is when you inject it in your bloodstream, it stops melanin production. Now what it do, it can't make you any whiter than what you were born with, you know? And so people claim to use this. There aren't any long-term FDA studies to support it. It does cause renal toxicity, so it does cause kidney failure in some cases. But again, we don't have the data to understand the long-term effects or the short-term effects.
Okay.
There are studies being done, and it may come out that in certain doses, it may be good for dull skin. In certain doses, it may be good for pigmentation.
Okay.
But we don't have that data as yet.
All right. Okay, so the next question is specifically aimed at your brand, and she says that her the Daily Peel broke her out, and she thinks it's a purging reaction. So basically, what is purging, and how should she use the basic brightening, extra gentle Daily Peel, and when not to use it, for how long to keep it on your face, what to layer it.
Sure. With? So in our new packaging, all these instructions will be provided.
Great.
Just putting that out there. But so you can purge. So you have to understand the skin is like a tree. It kind of goes from the bottom up. And what happens is that if you have, you know, things that kind of gunk, like what I like to call gunk, which is like particles of dead skin, pollution, that are kind of stuck, they kind of accelerate. So when you dissolve the top layer of your skin is like, oh my God, I need another top layer. So it goes a little faster.
Okay.
So as a result, what will happen is that you will end up getting a lot more of what would have come out eventually at a much faster rate. That happens with retinoids, happens with AHAs, can happen with BHAs. So you just, it's something that doesn't happen to everyone, but it can happen to someone. So it's something you need to be aware of.
So how do we detect it? Like, how do we know this is purging and this is not like a breakout?
It's a little difficult. Like, there's no hard and fast rule. So I think if you get acne where you usually get acne, that may be purging. If you're getting acne all over your face, that could be an allergic reaction. You have to pay attention to the kind of acne that you're getting. You know, so it's not like I said, it's not an easy differentiation. And it's an individual thing. Like I said, not everyone purges.
But purging goes away automatically in like 2 weeks or something, right?
So 2 weeks to a month, depending on the person. And if you're using a retinoid or an acid regularly, then you shouldn't get it back until you stop.
Okay.
So as long as you're using it regularly. Now about using the peel, there's a couple of ways you can use it. One is you can use it as a mask. So when you're done washing your face, you put it on for about 5 minutes, take a wet towel and wipe it off. The other is take a thin layer, like one pump at the most, and apply it overnight. And the third
this
thing...
This is your Daily Peel?
This is my Daily Peel.
Yeah.
And the third thing is you can use it as a spot treatment. Now, when you're using this, it's important to know that don't apply it if your skin is feeling irritated, flaky. Don't apply it if you chemically exfoliated in the last day, 2 days, 3 days. Wait for a week between chemical exfoliation. My peel is in a lotion peel, the extra gentle Daily Peel. So it releases a lot slower, so it's great for starters. Like, okay. It was designed to be for someone who's never worked with acids before. When you're in a serum base, for example, it absorbs a lot quicker. When you're in a lotion base, it gets released a lot slower.
Okay.
So it's easier, and you have the lotion to help trap the moisture, to help buffer the irritation if there's any.
Okay.
So that's the important thing to note. Almost every skin type can use it, unless, like I said, you have irritated skin, red skin, inflamed skin, broken skin. Like if you just burst a pimple, don't put it on that. You know what I mean? Wait for it to heal and then put it, you know. So those are some reasons you shouldn't use it.
So what would be like the go-to product if somebody starting with chemical exfoliation from your skincare range? What is it that you would like advise one product? Is it the Daily Peel, or do you think it's the ABC cleansing gel?
So I think an ABC, they're both different. So I think if you want to experiment with chemical exfoliation, so there's three products that we have, right? And all three of them
for
are
beginners.
Like for beginners.
Yeah.
So you have the ABC cleansing gel, which is 2.5% and 2.5% glycolic and lactic, and 0.5% of salicylic. So that's a wash up product. So the ABC cleanser is great, but I don't recommend it for dry and sensitive skin.
Okay.
For dry and sensitive skin, I would recommend the Daily Peel, because it's a lotion base that gives you the hydration as well. And in between, if you're combination skin, I would use the Gulabin glycolic.
Okay.
That's 5% glycolic acid, and it's formulated very gently. It's got a lot of buffers like aloe and a couple of other things that are just escaping my brain right now. But it's we paid a lot of attention to make sure it doesn't tingle or sting or things like that.
Dark circles is a hot topic. Oh my God, everybody wants to ask what is it that they can do. Apart from getting fillers and like not going into invasive treatments, what can they do at home? Do green tea bags really work? I don't have dark circles. So,
I mean, icing, green tea bags, these things work modestly. At the end of the day, it depends on why you have your dark circles. If you're getting dark circles because you're not sleeping right, you need to sleep right.
Correct.
If you're getting dark circles because of eczema, you need to make sure that your under eyes are already well hydrated. I think that's something that people can do at home.
Yeah.
That use a moisturizer. Even if you don't want to invest in an under eye cream, use a moisturizer because that's the least you can do for dark circles. Of course, like you said, if we're not talking about fillers, we're not talking about in-office procedures, then at home, use a moisturizer or retinoid. You know, like usually a retinoid formulated in an under-eye formulation is ideal to help you with the dark circles.
So this is something from my end. I'm going to stop with the questions. Yeah, I think we've tapped on most of the queries, like taken on everything that people ask. And one thing that I want to ask from my side, what do you think about the whole 10-step Korean skincare routine that was all the hype some time back? Now we've like migrated a little vocal for local. But the 10-step Korean skincare was something I didn't do, but I strongly considered. So are your thoughts about
it? If you want to do it and it makes you happy, by all means.
I don't want to buy 10 products earlier.
I'm too impatient. You don't need 10 products. No one needs 10 products. If there's anything you need, it's sunscreen. Everything else is optional.
This is what I said in my chemical exfoliation video as well.
So you don't want to chemically exfoliate? Yay for you. You don't want to use retinoids, that's great. But please use sunscreen. Because sunscreen can really damage your skin. Sun, which includes visible
sunscreen
light.
Sunscreen will not damage your
sunscreen
skin.
Sunscreen will not damage. But the sun, which includes IR, infrared rays, visible light, the heat, UV rays, all these things will really irreversibly damage your skin. And you know what? If you use sunscreen now, you're saving yourself in Botox expenses in a few years. So that's one thing I think that, you know, we can use.
I'm using my sunscreen, so good. I don't have to come for Botox.
Good.
All right then. So I think we can wrap up for today's video. Thank you so much for doing this for my audience.
It was fun. I'm glad that
that we did this.
We did this.
Yay! I'm so happy. If you have any other questions, if you have enjoyed your time here, and if you wanted to come back on my channel, then we can do that too.
We can.
I'm gonna come back here. Alright, you guys. So thank you so much for watching this video. If you're new to my channel and you've not hit the subscribe button, then please make sure that you do. If you've not checked out Dr. Shade skincare products, then make sure that you do. I'm gonna leave the link down below. And also, I have a code with them, so you can use my code so that you get a 20% off their entire website. And I feel
subscribe and use her code.
Yeah.
These are the two things you have to do.
That's all you have to do. For today's video, the Sara Sports shout out goes to Preeti Nayak. Thank you so much for watching and supporting my channel. If you want to be a part of next video's Sara Sports shout out, then all you have to do is hit the subscribe button, the bell icon right next to it, and also leave a comment down below saying hashtag Sara Squad, and you'll get a chance to be a part of my next video's Sara Sports shout out. I will see you guys very soon in another video. Bye guys, stay home, stay safe, and I love you.
And wear sunscreen.